Listening Library presents Cover Up by John Feinstein. This is John Feinstein. Chapter 1. Cut from the team. Dad, I think they're here. Stevie Thomas was staring out the front window of his house, which offered a view of the entire street. He had been sitting on the couch, ostensibly reading a book, but he had read exactly one page in an hour because he kept looking out the window. He was too nervous to focus on the descriptions of igneous, sedimentary, and metamorphic rocks in the earth science book that was spread out on his lap. Now, finally, he saw a black town car turn onto Pelfrey Lane, and he was pretty certain it'd be stopping at his door. "I'll be right down," Bill Thomas called back from upstairs. "Offer them something to drink." His dad had left his law office early to be home for the 6 o'clock meeting. Stevie's mom and little sister Katie were in an ice skating lesson. Stevie knew something bad was about to happen, even though his dad insisted he was jumping in shadows. The call had come from US TV on Monday. "We'd like to get together with you and your dad before you leave for Indianapolis," Tal Vincent, the producer of Kids Sports, had said to Stevie on the phone. "No need for you to come down here. We know you've got school. Mike and I will come to you." To Stevie, that was a sign something was very wrong. Mike Shoup doesn't fly to Philadelphia to meet with a co-star of a show unless it's something really important, he had told his dad. "I think they're canceling the show." Mike Shoup was the executive producer of US TV's original programming unit. He was the creative force that had made US TV a serious rival to ESPN in the world of all sports cable television. It had been Shoup's idea to have two teenagers host a weekly show on US TV aimed at teenage viewers. And it was Shoup who had convinced both their parents that Susan Carol Anderson and Stevie were made to star on Kids Sports. Stevie and Susan Carol were both only 14, but they had stumbled into something resembling stardom by helping solve two mysteries. One at the Final Four in New Orleans when a star player had been blackmailed to throw the national championship game, the other in New York at the U.S. Open tennis tournament when a glamorous Russian teenage star had disappeared just before her first match. Stevie and Susan Carol had earned the chance to cover the Final Four by winning a writing contest sponsored by the U.S. Basketball Writers Association. The aspiring young sports writers had gotten off to a rocky start. He was an opinionated northern kid who liked the Big East and the Big Five. She was an equally opinionated Southern girl who worshipped at the altar of Mike Krzyzewski and Duke. She was also annoyingly tall, at least 5'8" to Stevie's 5'4". But she had turned out to be very smart and, too tall or not, very pretty. By the time they met again at the U.S. Open, Stevie had a full-blown crush on her. Plus, they made a great team. Together, they had proven that Nadia Simonova's kidnapping had been a well-planned hoax. And by the end of the week, Susan Carol admitted that she really liked Stevie, too. Well, her goodbye kiss had said so anyway. That adventure had taken its toll, though. Stevie had been beaten up by a couple of thugs, but Susan Carol had it worse. It turned out her uncle Brendan had been a part of the hoax and was likely to end up in jail. That may have been why her father had declared future big-time sports events strictly off-limits. Stevie's parents weren't thrilled either with the goings-on in New York, which was why all the parents had balked when Mike Shoup called to say he wanted to make their kids into TV stars. Even Susan Carol hadn't been too excited about the idea. "We're writers, remember?" she had said to Stevie on the phone. "TV's for pretty people who read from a teleprompter." "Well," Stevie said, "you're pretty, and I know how to read." "Shut up, Stevie," Susan Carol laughed. But Shoup was persistent. He had visited both families in their homes. He'd offered a lot of money. "Even if the show only lasts a year," he had said to Bill Thomas, "you will have paid for Stevie's college education." Stevie's dad laughed at that one. "Obviously you don't have kids, Mr. Shoup," he'd answered. "If you triple what you're offering, you might be right about paying for college." Shoup hadn't tripled the offer, but he had almost doubled it, and he arranged it so the half-hour show would be taped on Friday afternoons. Neither kid would miss any school. Stevie would go to a TV studio in Philadelphia, Susan Carol to a studio in Fayetteville, North Carolina. They would discuss the sports events of the week on a satellite hookup. They would respond to emails from other kids, and occasionally they would interview a guest. Bill Thomas and Don Anderson had spent a lot of time talking on the phone. Finally, they decided to let the kids try it for 1 year. If it affected their schoolwork at all, if the parents weren't comfortable with how it was affecting them or their lives, the show would be over. Deal, said Stevie and Susan Carol. Deal, said Shoop. The show had debuted on the first Saturday in November. The reviews were very good. People marveled at how much Stevie and especially Susan Carol knew about sports. Both of them became stars at their schools. And Susan Carol, who looked a lot more like 18 than 14, was flooded with mail from love-struck teenage boys. Stevie even got some mail from love-struck teenage girls. He loved every second of it. Susan Carol wasn't as sure. What if you fall for some ninth-grade girl at school? She asked him one night. Oh, come on, Scarlett, he said, calling her by the Gone with the Wind nickname he'd put on her at the Final Four because of her southern accent and ability to charm almost anyone into doing anything. If anyone should be jealous, it's me. What boy in the country doesn't want to go out with you? She paused. But I don't want to go out with any of them. Well, neither do I, he said, although he had to admit Andrea Fassler was pretty hot. She was also a couple of inches shorter than Stevie. US TV had lived up to all its promises, not asking the kids to do anything more than the show and an occasional promo for the show, until just before Christmas, when Tal Vinson had called to say that Shoop and everyone at the network thought it was very important that the show be done on location for the entire week before the Super Bowl. All of US TV's personalities would be there for the huge pre-championship media blitz. Both fathers immediately said no. US TV had responded by offering the following week off plus a financial bonus if the kids went. Naturally, they both wanted to do it. This was the Super Bowl, the biggest sporting event of the year. 95 million people watching. Tell you what, Bill Thomas said to Stevie, if you get permission from all your teachers, I mean all of them, you can do it. If one of them says no, it's no. Can you get Reverend Anderson to make the same deal? Stevie asked. He was certain Susan Carol would have no trouble getting out of 4 days of school. She had never gotten anything less than an A in her life. Stevie's grades were okay, mostly B's. See what your teachers say. Then I'll talk to Don, his father said. Much to Stevie's surprise, not only did every teacher say it was okay, but they all thought it was a great idea. When Stevie told his dad, he had shrugged and said, "All right then, it's fine with me." His mom wasn't quite so sure. Do you remember what happened the last two times we let the kids go to an event like this? She said. I know, his father answered. But they're going to be surrounded by people constantly. What trouble can they possibly get into? Susan Carol's parents had also relented, and so it was all set for both kids to fly to Indianapolis the Monday before the game. The best part of the deal, as far as Stevie was concerned, was that he would get to spend most of the week hanging out with Susan Carol, whom he hadn't seen except on a TV monitor since September. What I don't understand is why you have to be out there on Monday when the game isn't until Sunday, his dad had said. Stevie laughed at the question. Are you kidding, he said. First of all, the teams come in on Sunday. They practice every day. The practices are open to the media, his dad had said, interrupting. No, they're not, except to a couple of pool reporters in case someone gets injured or there's a fight or something. But the players and coaches are available to the media Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday in the mornings. Come on, Dad. You've seen TV tape of the media surrounding players during Super Bowl week. You don't live on Mars. Okay, fine, Bill Thomas said. What else is such a big deal? Everyone in sports is there. Actually, everyone is there, period. If someone's launching a movie, they show up to be interviewed because there's like a million media people there, and they're all looking for something to talk about. If someone has a book out, they're there. Running for office, go to the Super Bowl. Then there are the parties. Every night, there are parties everywhere. Just how do you know all this? Dad, I do know how to read. It hasn't been that long since the Eagles were in the Super Bowl. I read every word in the Daily News and the Inquirer that week. I even read a story on the fashions the Eagles' wives were going to wear at the game. Bill Thomas had his hands in the air, waving them to make his son stop. Okay, I get it, he smiled. Just your luck the Super Bowl is in a place even colder than here. The NFL liked to take the Super Bowl to a cold weather city about once every 5 years. And it decided to go to Indianapolis instead of Detroit because of the new dome stadium the Colts had opened a year earlier. Dad, it's the Super Bowl, he said. If they held it in the Gnome Dome, I'd be there. So it was all set. Then, out of the blue, came the call from Tal Vincent. Stevie knew his fear that the show was being canceled was probably silly. The ratings had been very good right from the start. He'd called Susan Carol to see if anyone had asked to meet with her. The only call she'd gotten was from USTV's PR guy, who wanted to set up interviews for her during the week in Indianapolis. Stevie had heard nothing about that. "Either he's going to call you later, or he's just figuring whatever I do, you'll do too," she had said. "Or it could be there's a lot more demand for you than me," Stevie said. "You're the glamorous one." "Stop it," she said. "Call me as soon as the meeting's over." Now, the doorbell was ringing, and as Stevie went to answer it, he was filled with...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.